It's time to get moving, time for us to have some fun. There's no time to hang around, our adventure's just begun. We'll be thinking about our friends as we chase the setting sun. But we're leaving them behind, we're on the run.
Hey guys, welcome to the RayQuest podcast, or RayQuest, or RayCast? I don't know, I'm playing around with names. I was thinking about, it was like most people have their podcast where it's like something cast, you know, and then we have RayQuest podcast, which is a little like long. Anyways, welcome to the RayQuest podcast. I'm Steph Raybro, and this is
Bitter Nerd Tristan,
and we are kind of filming this kind of late. It's like 10 o'clock at night, which isn't super bad, but I got to get up at like 6 o'clock tomorrow morning.
Yeah, we have day jobs.
Yeah, woo! But anyways, so let's do some podcasting. We actually have a list of topics to talk about, and we're going to try to do segments here. But first, if you've been following my channel at all, you may have noticed, A, the computer's fixed, so that's exciting, right? That was a nice little stressful but relaxing weekend.
It was like you had a curse on you.
So basically, I came home Thursday. Yeah, I believe it was Thursday. I was supposed to, it was Wednesday. Because I was supposed to come home and do the, was it Wednesday? Well, anyways, there was a day I was supposed to come home after school, and I was supposed to guest star on the Jam Cave. I was supposed to call in for like an hour and a half or so, and just kind of answer your guys' questions. And if we can, I guess at the end of the podcast I can do that. I didn't think about it doing it this, but why not, right?
Yeah.
And, I heard some beeping, and it turns out it was my hard drive failing, and then my power supply went bad. I wound up having to order a new motherboard, and after I got the computer up and running, the Cintiq went bad. Oh, that was a thing.
You could hear the music from the Brady Bunch whenever the Tiki Idol showed up playing.
But yeah, my Cintiq was projecting a magenta or dark blue colors, depending on how you wiggled it, and the cord was shorting, and if you ever look at the older Cintiqs, and the new ones, I actually looked at school, they actually have three cords and it's a lot easier. With this one, it was, they're kind of merged together into one giant cord, and so I thought I would have to order a unique cord, or, just get a new Cintiq. A lot of you people were like, well, Steph, why don't you just, send it off with the warranty? I'm like, this Cintiq's been owned. It was made in 2008. I think I owned it somewhere in 2009 or 2010, but I checked their website, and their warranties are exclusively 2 years.
Jeez.
After that, you're done. I mean, these are expensive equipment. They want you to buy as much of it as possible.
Yeah, you were just having a bad week. I mean,
yeah.
But the clouds parted, and the sun finally shined through.
My beautiful, beautiful friend Josh came over, and he's an electrician engineer. And he was able to take apart the Cintiq, pull out the DVI cord that went corrupted, and we just, for $25, I bought another DVI and was able to replace it. And I don't know if you can tell, but my screen's actually a lot crisper and a lot cleaner. Mostly because I was using a converter cable on top of the DVI before, and now with the new motherboard, I'm able to just go straight DVI.
Nice.
So it's clear. It's actually HD now. Not like, high def. Like, it's not HD, but it's definitely like in that area. So that's super exciting for me.
Our sound waves look super sexy on this screen right now.
But yeah, so that was awesome. Out of everything, all the stress that I had this weekend, I did come out of it with a slightly better computer. The hard drive's bigger, the motherboard's slightly better, and the power supply supplies so much more power, and now the Cintiq's clear. So, I really want to stop and thank everyone that was super supportive. I got a lot of really nice comments, aside from people telling me to check the warranty. Just in general, a lot of people were like, oh, I hope you do it. And even some of you guys asked to fund some of it. It didn't come to that, thankfully. I was, like I said, $25 fix. Awesome. There was a bunch of different options that popped up that was really cool. Yomama, for example. Zach and Alex, they actually offered to buy me a new Cintiq if I needed to, which was an option, but I didn't want them to have to do that for me, you know. It's one of those things where I'm just like, I need to do this myself. And
you didn't have to go with the nuclear option.
So I know there's cheaper alternatives to the Cintiq. My only reason why I wasn't really thrilled about potentially going to those is because I feel like I have, like, the best of the best right now. And I feel like going back is down. I know it's really weird, but, like,
It's the best of the best 6 years ago.
6 years ago. But I like my Wacom, you know, I like my Cintiq. I did pay for a name brand, but it's like having a really expensive car and then going to a slightly less one. It always feels like a downgrade. And not that I'm like in that where I'm like, oh, I got the coolest stuff, but I just, you know, if I was going to get another, if I was going to spend $500 to $600 to $2,000 worth of money, I would like to, you know, get the best of the best.
I mean, that and I wouldn't be surprised if somewhere on this thing you've got your initials carved somewhere.
I don't. Why would I carve my initials in it?
I don't know. You just seem so attached to it.
Well, it's my livelihood. It's the it's what pays the bills. I mean, like, you know, a Cintiq, my Cintiq when I bought it was $2,000.
Oh, and that hurts my heart.
Except for I could pay that back in like a couple of months if I didn't have my student loan. But like, for the most part, you know, like I make that money back easily. Mm-hmm. And so I can warrant the purchase.
Yeah.
It's just the reason I was freaking out financially was I haven't paid my taxes yet, and that's going to take out, like, I have a good amount in my bank right now. But I'm freelance, so that means during tax time where everyone's, like, running around screaming, I got my tax money, can't wait to buy stuff. I'm like, I lose all my money. So, I do want to do with the podcast, I want to kind of, like, give us a little bit more structure so we have different segments. The first thing I want to talk about is cartoon or TV show recap. This is where, let's take a break. I want to push that aside and kind of talk about, what we've been doing. So, like, while I wasn't playing my game, while I wasn't working on stuff because I didn't have a computer, I wound up buying Wind Waker HD for the Wii U. Even though I have, like, 12 games in the queue that I need to play, including Bayonetta 2, Roller Coaster Tycoon Deluxe Edition on Steam.
Oh, I was like, I really didn't know that was on the Wii U.
No, I really like Roller Coaster Tycoon. When I get a little bit like, when I'm not worried about the Try Hard Ninja music video, I'm going to start live streaming a little bit more, and then what the live streams will be put on the Steph Game Channel. It's just one of those things where I really want to play Roller Coaster Tycoon. I really like Roller Coaster Tycoon.
I never knew this about
it. Oh, I loved it as a kid. I also want to play Digimon World. I got the converter. I did buy a piece. With the PlayStation 3, you can't just play directly through stream it. So I got the thing to trick it into recording for me. So expect Digimon World and stuff like that.
And he'll be doing voices the whole time.
Oh yeah.
Super Shocker!
That's not even the good one. Let me try that again. Super Shocker! I give up. Anyways, so let's talk about things we played recently or watched. For me, it was Wind Waker HD. I do have a story that's not related to actually playing Wind Waker HD. It's me buying it. I will not shop at GameStop anymore. Locally, there was no copies of Wind Waker HD brand new. Like, no Walmart, no Target, no Best Buy, anything. It's gone. And, so the only option I had was GameStop. And, without even questioning, I'm just like, I want Wind Waker HD. And they're like, alright, they pull it out and look for a little bit. So I know that was the last copy, you know, that it took them a little while to find it. Mm-hmm. And so I'm waiting for him to pull it out, and then this kid next to me comes up, little tiny kid, and he's just like, I'm looking for Wind Waker. And I'm just like, oh no, I have the last copy. He's gonna get the last copy, cause I can't do that to a kid. I really wanna play Wind Waker, and I'm probably gonna be giving it up. And, he's like, for the GameCube? And I'm like, yes, inside, you know, like inner dialogue. Like, yes!
There's no disc replay near there anymore for him to get it.
We have a local store. We used to have a local store called Disc Replay. I'm sure there's plenty wherever your local, like equivalent of it, but Disc Replay was a used gaming store that sold all kinds of games and movies.
Mm-hmm. Like, everything from Nintendo to current.
Yeah, it was awesome. Like, if you want Super Nintendo games, they're a little bit more expensive than I would like them to be, but... Mm-hmm. They had them. Anyway, so the guy's like, well, he kind of directed them to like a city over, like, place that might have it, but that wasn't killing it. And so the poor kid, me and my roommate, if that kid was going to still be there by time for us to drive home and get our GameCube copy of Wind Waker, because I think me and him both own a copy of it anyways. Aww. We were going to give it to him, but we just didn't have time.
Aww.
Yeah. You know, thinking about it, I probably could have just played my GameCube version of Wind Waker, but I really wanted the HD graphics and experience it a new way.
Yeah.
And there is new stuff. There is new stuff. So, anyways, so
And Link can take selfies.
He can. On Miiverse, I put on a thing where I'm inside the pirate place, the Tetris like main area, and like I didn't notice this the first time playing through, but in the original game, but they do have like Link. That picture of Link in her her thing, like from the intro.
Oh, nice!
Like the little carvings, and they also have like Triforces everywhere, which is foreshadowing the fact that Tetra is Zelda. Spoilers! And I took a picture of the selfie with Link, and I go like, "One after one raid, bitch is crazy about me." Wow. I don't know if I phrased it that way, but I phrased it in a certain way, and it got a couple of yeahs. So, woo! But anyway, so the kid walked off, and I got my copy. I go to pay it, and they're like, it's $53. And I'm just like, $53? It's $49.99. And I'm like, this is pre-owned. And like, yeah, it is. And I go, but that's the same price of it brand new. And they're like, well, the game was kind of, they discontinued it. It doesn't, you know, you can't get a new copy anywhere anymore. And it's a little rare. They didn't make that many copies. So we're able to charge that much. And like, if it wasn't for the fact that I could not get that game anywhere else at that time, I would have just been like, no, I will do it through Amazon.
Gamazon.
I didn't want, because with the computer broken, there was like a little window of me just being able to play games. And so that was like, you know, I'm gonna buy it. I'm going to buy it for the convenience so I don't have to wait a couple of days and then my computer be fixed and I can't play video games again. You know? And, so I bought it, and then I checked, and, like, Kmart, if I bought it off their website, it's, like, $45. So not only was it full price, but it may have been $5 to $10 overpriced.
Jeez.
And it's just, I'm dumb at GameStop. They saved my butt a couple of times with, like, I got the Majora's Mask with the statue through GameStop. Granted, I'm getting the strategy guide, which was a bundle they created themselves to sell their strategy guides. And then I also got the Mega Man Amiibo through, GameStop. But beyond that, I'm done. I'm over GameStop. Have you been playing anything?
Oh, actually, no. I've been playing the Pokemon trading card game online.
Oh, yeah?
They released some new updates for the Ruby and Alpha set. And it's interesting. It's like nobody knows what they're playing with right now. Like,
really?
Usually it's just EX Pokemon everywhere. And, like, right now they've got all these new EXs and nobody knows what to do with them.
Huh. Well, I might be able to do for the gaming channel. We could play a match. I beat you last time.
Yeah.
I use the default deck on the thing. I don't really collect the cards.
If it's perfect strangers, I can kick their ass. But if it's people I know...
Okay, while we're fixing my computer, my friend came over here and I wound up, like, playing Smash Brothers with him. Had to use the bathroom. And I'm like, you know, choose my character for me, surprise me.
Oh, no.
And, like, if it was anyone like Robin or Captain Almar or something like that, I would have been done for, because I suck with those characters. He chose Jigglypuff. and he's like, you know, tee-hee-hee-hee. I'm like, oh, because I can't see because we're choosing the stage and stuff. And it pops up, and I'm like, Jigglypuff, really, dude? And he's like, yeah, I figured you'd be really bad at it. I'm like, okay. And then he never touched the ground. it was just like I've opened up a TeePublic store, right? And to segue it into selling things, I haven't made a shirt or anything, but I do want to make some Smash Brothers oriented shirts, because I think those would do really well.
Cool.
And it'd just be really fun. One of them was, I wanted to like make a pun off Jigglypuff instead of Jigglypuff, Jiggly Ruff.
Yeah,
like I'm gonna get Jiggly Ruff with you or something like that. Another one was, I thought maybe like using the spelling for Wii U with like Wii Smash U, and then like have the 8 original characters with like, I want to do like the paint stroke effect they have like with all the, you know, Challenger.
Yeah,
but you know,
that'd
so
be cool.
So Pokemon trading card game.
Yeah, it's just. Usually, I had to build my deck on there just to keep from getting my butt handed to me by people with all these Pokemon EXs.
Mm.
And now it's like, even then I'd still get, it was 50-50, I would win or lose. And today somebody came at me with like Kyogre EX and then Mega evolved it into Primal Kyogre. And then couldn't get any energy or anything for any of the attacks on any of their other Pokemon.
Really?
So, like, 5 turns in, they're just like, I quit.
That.
Like, 4 times in a row that happened.
I wound up watching Alien Force. Mm-hmm. I've been kind of going through that again. Something I've always wanted to kind of do reviews of, like, cartoons, just because I think I could give a really interesting opinion, being an artist and animator myself. Yeah. And, you know, I was always inspired by people like Nostalgia Critic, CR, Pushing Up Roses, etc. Like, I like many people, watch reviewers on YouTube. So, like, I'm a really big fan of certain ones. Like, they call me Johnny Versus. Like, I really love his stuff. I enjoy, I'm trying to think of who, it's blanking on me. Did my computer just turn off? No, we're good. Okay. By the way, new computer, a lot of weird stuff. Don't want to go into sleep mode, and it kind of just started going to sleep mode. But anyways, I'm, you know, a big fan of, you know, they call me Johnny. I'm a big fan of, CR. I really love CR. Who else? Is there someone else? JonTron. You know, I'm a big fan of those type of people. And so, like, I never really thought I'd be doing Watch Me Draw videos. Like, I never thought I would get a following through it, if anything, yeah. Because I thought people would think they're boring. And I'm sure there's plenty of people. It's definitely an interesting niche. I think a lot of people are kind of always holding out for animation, so that's a lot more entertaining, I think. But I do inspire people, which is really, really cool.
That's
cool. So, like, I always want to do kind of reviews, and eventually I will. It takes a lot of time. You know, you have to write it. You have to record your voice, do editing and such like that. And for me, it always got ran into the point of, like, I'll write something and then I'll read it out loud and then hate myself. But with reviews, I always kind of want to do a Ben 10 retrospective going through each season and how the changes. Kind of like how Jessica Otaku did Digimon, mm-hmm. and then Welshi did the Saw series. Like, I feel like Ben 10 would be my version of that.
Would you, like, do it more like them, or kind of similar to, like, maybe Linkara with his history of Power Rangers?
Kind of like Linkara and the history of Power Rangers. Like, I don't want us to do like what we did in the first few podcasts, where it's just like just going through all the history. I mean, obviously history of the show itself, like what's going on. But, you know, just kind of like, because I really want to compare, like, Ben's psyche, the character Ben, between season 1 and 2 of Alien Force and then season 3 and 4. Because there's definitely a difference in writing. And rewatching it, I'm noticing that, like, every other episode, Ben changes personalities. Like, he goes from, like, going from season 1, where he's, like, this really mature character, to super cocky asshole. And it literally between episodes. Jeez. And it's just really weird and odd. And, like, just how they write the characters during season 3. But while watching it, I believe I was watching it with you at one point last week. I think before, maybe during the computer breaking.
I think it was during.
Yeah, I think I just invited you over because I was like, I need something. I need someone. I need a friend. And
lean on me.
I was watching it, and Alien Force has, like, the same quality of writing as, well, Doctor Who.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's sci-fi for the masses.
Mm-hmm. Well, at least for kids and Steven.
Yeah.
But yeah, like, I was just watching it, and I'm like, this feels very much like Matt Smith Doctor Who. Between, like, they're being, you know, Ben and then his two companions, they have a trap. Like, I know that's really, like, generalized stupid things. Like, well, that's nothing like it. They just use a vehicle? Well, then it's, like, Back to the Future. You don't know. But, I mean, just there's, like, certain things. Like, the episode we watched together was a guy driving a semi, drives off, he's being chased by aliens, he crashes the semi. He gets locked up in jail. The sheriff turns out to be an alien. Everyone in the town tends to be aliens, all with, like, masks hiding the fact that they're alien. Like, it makes it look human. And the guy has amnesia, so he doesn't know what's going on. Ben and them come save him. And they're trying to piece together this, like, you know, mystery of what's going on with the city and stuff like that. And then, lo and behold, boom, the kid that they've been helping out, the guy with amnesia, turns out to actually be an alien himself. And then, like, all the aliens are being converted from human.
Yeah.
And you just couldn't remember. And it was like, that felt very much like a Doctor Who plot.
Definitely, definitely.
And,
Doctor Who, Men in Black, I mean, it definitely, a little bit of X-Files.
Mm-hmm.
It had some vibes and cues from all of those.
And there's a lot of episodes during Alien Force that are very similar with, like, set up and a little bit of mystery of figuring out things. Mm-hmm. And that's very interesting. And, like, I know in the previous I've kind of talked down on Alien Force. I forgot how much I enjoyed Alien Force, and I really hated Ultimate Alien. I think Ultimate Alien's where it starts going downhill. There's definitely bits and pieces where I'm like, this is stupid with Alien Force. But it's not nearly, like, I respect a lot of the decisions, even though I don't like a lot of the decisions made.
Mm-hmm. It happens.
Mm-hmm. So now that we talked about that, I want to do a cartoon recap and then something new for the podcast. I think we're going to try to either watch a movie or a new TV series. So if you guys have any series in mind that you would like for us to watch for potentially the first time, for example, I haven't really watched much of Adventure Time. So like that would be like a first time viewing thing. But this week we have Nico Sword of, and the Sword of Light that we're going to talk about. I kind of gave Tristan an abridged version of it, mostly because it's really late at night tonight already. And so I didn't want to like watch the whole 20 minutes. So I just kind of cut it down and skipped ahead.
It's like if we want to do another up late with Stev and Tristan, we're going to have to take a nap.
I feel like it's going to be sexy. It sounds sexy. Up late with Stev and Tristan. Bow chicka
bow. I was thinking more like Troy and Abed at night, but okay.
Let's do it together. Troy and Abed in the morning. No, fuck. All right, so cartoon recap. We have three different shows I think we want to talk about. I know you're really excited about Power Rangers. We'll talk about Power Rangers in a moment. First, Ninja Turtles, because I feel like it's the shortest. The newest episode had characters looking for Karai, who previously in season two was Splinter and Shredder's daughter. Splinter's biological, Shredder's adopted, accidentally got turned into a snake, and they're back in New York looking for her. Really, the main thing this episode really follows is two characters that become Bebop and Rocksteady. Just tear that Band-Aid off. It wasn't that much of a spoiler talking about it, because apparently during Comic-Con, the animatic for the episode got put up. So, like, we already knew.
Toy shots have been up even before that.
Oh, no, the Ninja Turtle toys are really big spoilers. I took I accidentally read both Dog Pound and Xavier's, or Fish Face. I read both of their boxes and found out who they were before. Yeah. And it's like, dang it.
There was some series that actually talked about how they're not doing toys because toys are some of the biggest spoilers.
Hmm.
I can't remember what it was. I'm going to have to look that up later.
Okay. But anyway, so Bebop and Rocksteady's in the show finally. They're like the last like 30 seconds. Like even the credits are popping up at the bottom.
Oh man.
And that's exciting. Did you get to watch the episode?
I did not. Okay. I was work got in the way.
More or less the whole episode is you're with Bebop and Rocksteady in their human forms, which I can't remember their name. It's like Zeke's and something Russian.
Sergey or something?
Something like that. And, like, the entire time they're just like, I don't want to be a mutant. I want to get out of New York.
Yes, I'd like to get out of New York. You know, like, we have to work with Shredder. We get his daughter, you know, like, he let us out.
I don't know if that was Russian, but I don't know what that was. But
general purpose, wrong turn in New York accent.
Yeah. And so, like, the entire episode they're just talking about how they don't want to be mutated. And it's like, it's happening. You know it's going to happen. And so both them and the Turtles are looking for Karai. They both basically mess up. Karai gets away. She mentioned something about a meteor or something, or coming, comet or something, points to a direction. And that's basically the whole episode.
How did they encounter a rhinoceros and a warthog?
It was DNA samples that Baxter Stockman's been using for a while.
Okay,
so how they get transformed is, it's actually really cool. Shredder changes them. He decides that since they've been assholes to him, he's going to let Baxter Stockman create new mutants.
Okay, I thought it was an accident. I'm going to get something out of the way here.
Oh, yeah. I got a nice little basket from your mama for my birthday. It came a little week late, but Tristan's accidentally hitting the plastic of it. It was a nice little chocolate thing.
I'm sure you can hear that.
Can you stop? It's like we got away with it with you minimum, and then you had to make an example out of it. But anyway, so, like, they're both kind of, like, chained, and, what's great is when they mutate, they have different clothing, and their chains are different. So, like, you know, Shredder pops up, and it's like, your fates are sealed, you know, like, something six, you know, Bebop's character, you stole my helmet, and, you know, you betrayed me with the Karai thing, boom, you are a warthog now. God. And then, like, it's really weird because they keep their human voices, and I don't like it. Like, I want Bebop to have a different voice. So I just imagine, like, a high-pitched, like, black guy voice being like, I'm a warthog! You know, like, it just doesn't quite work. I don't know how they're going to get their names because they don't refer to themselves in the show yet. I don't know if they just give themselves a new one or whatever. And then, like, the Russian guy's like, but Shredder, we worked with each other. I'd be better as a normal guy, you know? And he's like, you tried to hunt my daughter. And you go, Warthog, or Rhino. And so they just drop them in the goop, and they come out as Bebop and Rocksteady. And it's like, we're free! snakes! Blah! And that's the end. Wow. It freeze frames with them both kind of roaring together.
Almost makes me wish they'd gone with Toka and Rezar instead.
We already got Rezar. He's in the show.
I know.
Yeah. It's good enough. Good enough for me. But yeah, so that's that. I'm excited about Bebop and Rocksteady, but really the only thing about that episode that's anything interesting is Bebop and Rocksteady's in it. Finally we got them. I know they've been in the intro for like 1 week, and so we got them. Now, next up is probably Gecko Mondo, or Mondo Gecko. I don't know why I always say it backwards.
I don't know why you mispronounce half the stuff you mispronounce.
Shut up, you. Tristan had to leave. He's no longer part of the podcast.
I must go. My people need me.
That is a Simpsons reference for those who don't know.
And if you don't know, please climb out from under the rock where you're getting internet access.
Some people might not watch The Simpsons. These youngins. But there's an episode of The Simpsons where Homer winds up voicing a character on the Itchy and Scratchy show, which is a cartoon that the kids love. And I guess, like, what's his name? Was it?
Poochie.
Who was supposed to be, like, that stereotypical cool guy character that gets added in. I think it's kind of a joke on Scrappy-Doo a little bit. Where they just add in a new hip character who kind of becomes the main focus. And I guess kids hated it. I can't remember. It's been a long time. And so, like, they just kind of cut him out completely, where, like, they just take an animation still and just raise it to the sky, and it, like, has, I don't know if it's a voiceover or, like, a text, but it says, my people need me.
Yeah, no, they do a voiceover with a different voice. It's like, I must go, my people need me. And then it cuts to his text that says, Poochie died on the way to his home planet.
So he's gone. So, what we got now is Power Rangers Dino Charge.
Holy smokes.
Tristan's excited. I'm kind of excited too. You guys know me. Like, on this thing, I'm always kind of like a little, like, I
wouldn't pull down the curtains. We're watching Power Rangers.
Yeah. Basically, what I do is I'll watch Power Rangers with like all the curtains down. Me like putting a blanket over my head and like looking at like something, you know, like a phone with headphones on, so no one knows what I'm doing. I don't know. Like, I guess I'm just kind of like embarrassed to be watching Power Rangers because I'm a 25-year-old. Well, I don't, like, watch it. I'm probably going to end up watching this season with Tristan. And I don't know. Like, this is the one guilt. Like, Ben 10, I brag about watching. But then, like, Power Rangers, I'm just like...
Oh, you don't have to worry about much. As soon as they hit episode 10, it's going to be 8 months before another episode.
So. Oh. But, like, with me, I guess with an animator, no matter what, if I'm watching kids' shows, everyone's going to be, he's just studying animation. He's watching. Like, Jacob Dobson, one of our old colleague of mine and mentor from school, he's just like, he went on like this whole anti like brony phase where he's just kind of like, he's really upset by all these boys watching it. And he's like, hey, these people need to grow up. And I'm like, well, you don't make fun of me for watching cartoons. He goes, oh, it's different. You're watching it because you're studying it. And I'm just like, no, I'm watching it because entertainment value.
Now, he also said that there's no, like, video games don't have good music, so.
Really?
Yeah.
Huh.
Erica, a friend of ours, had to school him on that one.
So Power Ranger Dino Charge. Tristan's excited. Explain it away, Tristan.
Well, 22nd, or 24th? God, I've lost track. They've split all the last few seasons into two seasons. But latest season of Power Rangers, there was not, like, brand new... new executive producer, Judd Lynn, Chip Lynn, whatever you want to call him, came in and basically said, the last 4 years have sucked. We're going to do something different. So, first episode, you've got 10 minutes of just the aliens that bring the powers to Earth fighting each other and setting each other up and setting up the plot. E.T. gives the dinosaurs some power gems.
There's a guy that looks like E.T. I feel like whenever we make jokes, I have to explain them. like, that's my job here.
Am I that old?
No, I'm not saying like E.T. I'm just saying, like, I literally did not explain E.T. I was just like, the guy looks like E.T.
Oh. Yeah, but like...
E.T. and Gizmo from Gremlins merge together and become a mentor and have gems. The gems get lost. Or he gives them to dinosaurs for them to go die.
Yeah, like, He gives the bad guys a bomb, not thinking that the bad guys are hauling all these asteroids for reasons.
Basically, Power Rangers killed off the dinosaurs.
Sorry, kids.
The villain of the series apparently collects meteorites, I guess, as like that's a payment in space, and he has a whole bunch of them. The ship gets destroyed because of a bomb that the the good guy placed in the box. He thought he was getting the Power Ranger Morphers, more or less, and instead he got a nice little bomb in his face. And because of that, the ship wound up releasing all the meteorites, hitting Earth, killing off all the dinosaurs.
Yeah, not 10 minutes later.
Yeah.
Even. And, like, he's got, like, I love the setup for the monsters this season.
Oh, because they're all captured. Like, he's a bounty hunter. So, like, he has this prison full of aliens, and I'm assuming it's probably going to be like, if you kill the Power Rangers, you could be free. You know?
Yeah, I mean, it's a nice setup. It's totally different from the Sentai. In fact, this first episode, there is not 1 second outside of the intro,
theme song?
Theme song.
There you go.
There is not 1 second of Sentai footage.
Yeah, that's awesome to hear. Basically, from the Power Ranger standpoint, only two Rangers get introduced. It's the Red and Pink Ranger, which both are not white, which is kind of a first for both of them, I think. Maybe. Mm-hmm. No, there's a Black Red Ranger.
Oh, yeah.
But, like, the cool thing, plot-wise, it's just basically the Power Rangers work at a museum. Some of them work in a fast food restaurant in the museum. The Red Ranger is a traveler that just likes to look for dinosaur stuff, and then the rest of the team is just researchers digging up stuff for the museum. And the Red Ranger has charisma.
Charisma, screen presence, and something better than a wood plank with a morpher.
He's funny and interesting, which is something I can't say for the last few Power Rangers that Tristan's introduced me to. Well,
they keep hiring supermodels.
Like how charisma this guy is. Like, think of Aladdin from Disney. And then put a Power Ranger suit on him.
Yeah. Guess where he learned his stunt work?
What's
he's
that?
He's a circus. He's from a family of circus performers.
That's cool.
So it's like, it might explain why he's actually got some presence and charisma.
Which, for a reason, made me want to talk about Dead Before Dawn, but you didn't enjoy that.
But it was hard.
It was good. It's a movie on Netflix. Watch it, guys. It's got Christopher Lloyd in it for like 10 minutes. And it's one of those, like, so bad it's good movies, but I really enjoy it a lot. It's about, Zemans, just check it out. It's, get past the first 10 minutes, that's pretty much unwatchable, but after that, I think it actually gets funny. Tristan begs to differ.
I it's not the worst movie I've ever seen. That goes to a little flick I found at a family video called The Item.
Okay.
That was bad.
But, so the Red Ranger is very charismatic, which is awesome. The Pink Ranger, she's bubbly. She's cute. I like her. I like, visually, she's pleasing on the eyes. That sounds really, really misogynistic. But, I think so far those two really won me over.
They have personality, mm-hmm. which is something we, already the first episode actually gives us a bit of, you know, a nice bit of backstory and personality on the Red and the Pink Ranger.
Mm-hmm.
We meet the Blue, who will become the Blue and the Black Ranger. We don't even see who's going to be the Green Ranger yet.
Oh, yeah. Is there only one girl on this team?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, for now.
For now. Way to be that guy, Tristan.
Okay. Since most people have access to the internet, Dino Charge will more than likely have 11 Rangers total.
Which normally have 5 to 6.
Yeah.
Or 3 to 4. They usually have somewhere between 3 and 6 Rangers, and now we have like 7 or 11.
Yeah.
I thought the, for a reason, there's always a Yellow Ranger. This is the first time there wasn't a Yellow Ranger for the most part, except for some older ones. And so, like, I just assumed the blonde chick that was in the thing that told the Pink Ranger, no, you cannot. You are a burger joint person.
Yeah.
Don't you be trying to do this. We went to college for this. And then, the best joke is, like, the Blue and Black Ranger show up.
And they're just goofing around.
And she's like, well, these people are highly trained. And then, like, the camera goes onto them, and they're both doing really stupid stuff. But it's, like, that kind of moment, like, with your group of friends. You try to introduce something to them, and they're just like, you know, I think one of them's like eating a burger with the stuff falling out of his mouth and stuff. It's like, yeah, those guys are highly trained. But yeah, so like, there's actually like something you wouldn't expect from Power Rangers, a big focus on story.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, I'm a story guy. When I teach my classes at the college I go to, or college I work at, that's really hard to talk about. One of the biggest emphasis I do have, aside from, like, you know, the principles of animation, is story. I'm a firm believer that if, okay, yeah, cool, you can do Dragon Ball Z fight scenes, which is something that's really popular for people to do. You know, oh yeah, I'm gonna do Goku fighting each other. And it's like, well, what's the point? What's the story behind it? And it's like, oh, I don't have one, I just wanna do something fighting. I'm like, that's cool, but that's not gonna keep people there. I think people deep down really want substance. Yeah. They don't just want big explosions and Power Rangers shooting each other. They want something more. Yeah. Like, because we are Dino Shards, let's talk about Jurassic Park here, for example. People love the first Jurassic Park, not because there's dinosaurs, because there's a story behind it.
I love how you said that, just like the little animated DNA stream.
Just like the little, yeah. I spared no expense, but, and then Jurassic Park 2, not really that strong of a story, and no one talks about it. It has just as good special effects. It's not the special effects.
Yeah.
It's the story. And I do think Dino Charge is really banking on the new Jurassic Park movie doing well. I feel like it's really hoping.
Yeah, it came out at the perfect time. I mean, Mighty Morphin came out at the same time as Jurassic Park.
Did it?
Yeah, I mean, it was very close. It was like the dino boom of the 90s.
Well, I mean, kids love dinosaurs. That's a fact. I loved... Oh, speaking of people loving dinosaurs, one of the most forced things in this thing is... so the Pink Ranger is the Triceratops... Triceratops Ranger, and there's a point where it's like, oh, we're going for a dig. A Triceratops? That's my favorite dinosaur! And I'm just like, no one, like, even if you have a favorite dinosaur, there is no, like... You know, like, oh, hey, I'm making a ham sandwich. Ham sandwich? That's my favorite ham sandwich. That's my favorite sandwich. No one does that. It felt super, super forced.
It did, but, you know, there are people who do get kind of goofy about what they...
One of them.
Yeah.
She does not look like that type. I mean, it'd be like writing, say, like, a ninja season where it's like... A shinobi blade? That's my favorite sword, you know? It just doesn't happen.
Oh, Lord.
But overall, it does seem promising. Like, if all the seasons of Power Rangers, aside from, like, the original series, up to space, well, you know, space itself, or maybe Dino Charge, or Dino Thunder, this is the first time I actually could see myself getting excited for Power Rangers, even as a 25-year-old. And mostly because of Tristan. It's all for you. It's not for me. I do this for you, buddy.
Hey, just remember, I'm 29.
Ha! That was me.
Hey, I was old enough to watch the first episode of Power Rangers as it aired and remember it. I was freaking out as a kid, I won't lie.
I watched it in syndication. You know, Power Rangers is a weird thing for me. Because, like, I remember Mighty Morphin. I don't remember anything from Zeo. And then I remember Turbo... I remember Space. I kind of vaguely remember, like, in Galaxy, but I don't think I got back into it until in Time or whatever.
Time Squad.
Yeah. Time Squad. Time Force. You know, whatever. And then after that one, I dropped it. Like,
yeah.
But, like, I have a weird history of Power Rangers. Because it's weird to, like, drop, like, because I remember Turbo, but not Zeo. Like, what happened that between gap, you know? But I
Digimon.
Digimon. Oh, hey. I'm looking at my Digimon figurine sitting at my desk. There's Bulbasaur over there, like, a little jealous. On another desk.
You're just gonna wake up and this thing's gonna be staring at your chest. Just be like, why are you looking at them like that?
He's referring to a Bulbasaur. Remember, we're audio. If anyone's wondering why we dropped the thing, there's just a lot of complications with doing video. And so, with me being kind of behind on a bunch of stuff, I still want to produce a podcast because I want to give you guys some kind of content and it's fun to do. I just didn't want, there was just so many complications with rendering video that I don't think it's happening this time. I think we're just going to I'll probably do a little bit of image work in the post-production, watch there be nothing. But otherwise it's probably going to end up with just, you know, audio and video.
We'll make footage. We could make like the footage stuff like a special event or something.
Well, the footage stuff got flagged, remember?
Oh, live action? Of us. Yeah. You know, like the live stream, like do it once a year or something.
Maybe not once a year. It would be something. But let's talk about Steven Universe, because that has two episodes we need to talk about.
Yeah.
Future Vision and On the Road. Future Vision is a really good episode from Steven and Garnet.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, Garnet reveals that she can see the future. All possible outcomes, and then she kind of lets Steven know that there's like 100 different ways he can die, and it kind of starts freaking out Steven a little bit. Like, she at first is like, I don't think you're ready. You're not old. This is a bad idea. And he's like, no, I can handle it. And then the entire episode is him just trying to prevent his death. And
all animated, all cutesy-like, too.
quick spoiler, skip 30 seconds ahead if you haven't seen the episode. Basically, she reveals that she tells him not to get on the roof. And he gets on the roof and she goes, let's find out what's going to happen. I'm ready to take it as a man or whatever. And like, Garnet's just like, well, I knew what was going to hurt you. And I didn't want it to be me, and it was me. Mm-hmm. And it was just like this little moment, like where they both just really somber. It was nice.
You don't get many good Garnet focused episodes.
No, she works so well, and just as being like that really silent and kind of a little blurb here and there. But this, I think, aside from Garnet Universe, this is the first time we got to really hang out with Garnet within mm-hmm. the show.
Yeah, and then
on the road, a really good Amethyst episode.
Oh my god.
I wound up watching this with a friend while we're working on the computer, so like I had to watch it a second time before the podcast. And besides a really interesting musical number, we find out a little bit more history about Garnet and the Gems. We don't know a lot, but we know enough now that we can kind of piece some stuff together. Amethyst winds up getting a little upset because Pearl and Garnet are talking about how the Gems were supposed to do something to the Earth, decided against it, and now they're there to protect it. They decided Earth is their place. But Amethyst feels a little left out in the conversation. And Steven and Amethyst decide to
run off because Steven's been reading a book series.
Yeah. And she winds up taking him to the kindergarten, a place where apparently Gems were born to do something to the Earth. Amethyst refers to them as parasites, which is interesting because Tristan brought up a really good observation that
the drills look like viruses.
Yeah, which parasects. All right, am I saying that right?
That's a Pokemon.
I knew it was like that. Parasites. Sounds right. What's that?
Parasite.
Parasites and viruses. Infecting the Earth. So we definitely know that Gems from the not the ones we're familiar with, the other Gems, are bad news for the Earth. We know that. We got enough of that there. We did find out that Amethyst is born from a hole in the wall.
On Earth.
On Earth. So she's an Earth Gem. And that, obviously something went wrong with her to make her good. And while Pearl does not want Steven to know about any of this stuff, like, Pearl winds up showing up, figuring that they'll find him there. And Pearl's like, how much did you tell him, you know?
And she just keeps saying more.
Yeah. And it's just one of those things where, like, Pearl's like, he's not ready. So, like, we're going to eventually find out about this information. But for whatever reason, Pearl's trying to hide it from Steven. She definitely seems ashamed of the whole event, which is really putting a lot of personal turmoil on Amethyst, who sees herself as a mistake.
Yeah. She's the... If they were all brother... If they were all sisters, you could almost see Amethyst was the unplanned baby.
The unplanned baby or the adopted one.
Yeah. And, I mean, she just, all this emotion and then it leading to this really well done fight scene
between very
Pearl
well done.
And Amethyst.
During that fight scene, this is really weird, but it reminded me of Super Mario RPG.
I see that.
Something about how the characters, because, you know, Pearl fights with, like, this whole ballerina-style thing, which is it seems like a quirky development that an RPG, like Super Mario RPG, would do. It reminds me of, like, Geno and Milo and stuff like that. And then, like, Amethyst is just, like, really brutal and, like, turning into, like, a spinning wheel and stuff like that.
She goes Sonic on their butts.
Again, it's something that makes me feel like, I don't know, maybe it's the 8-bit music they tend to apply to stuff. Mm-hmm. But, like, it really hit that same kind of beat. And maybe it's just because this whole mystic, like, space, Earth stuff, which is a very big part of Super Mario RPG. But for a reason, I'm hitting it. And maybe it might be the fact that Steven Universe is getting a Paper Mario-styled RPG for the Android. So I'm kind of in that mindset.
Hopefully it's good.
It looks pretty decent.
But seeing all those holes, like, there wasn't just one hole for Amethyst. Like, there were all these holes in the mountainside.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm wondering, maybe Amethyst is, like, a mass-produced gem.
Mm.
Like, she's the worker force for the gems.
Well, no, that's definitely what's implying, is that the gems, like, basically started kindergarten. And then the gems that, like, come out of that. So, like, one gem comes to the Earth, starts it up, and those are the ones that take over.
Mm-hmm.
In some form. Which, man, something that's really interesting about Steven Universe versus, like, Adventure Time. I've only seen, like, the first, like, season and some additional pieces of Adventure Time, so I can't completely talk about it. But, like, Adventure Time seems like it has, like, a very loose continuity. Like, they're slowly kind of writing as they go. Steven Universe definitely feels like it has a very intense, show Bible dedicated to it. And they just, like, because they definitely know where they're going with it since the very beginning. Because they've been peppering in the dialogue with quick little throwaway lines that enhance the story.
Yeah, it's like if Avatar The Last Airbender had been written with 11-minute episodes. Like, they knew what they were doing from the start.
And it just makes a really, really in-depth story, a very enriched world. And it feels like we're finding information very organically. Mm-hmm. Now, it is holding back on some information here and there, I think a little, especially whenever Pearl's involved. It seems like
it's almost like Steven trusts her enough to be like, I'm not going to ask questions you don't want to answer.
I feel like Steven should be asking more questions, but
he should, but we got to remember his strongest power is his compassion.
That's true. And that, and like Steven Universe, one, I wouldn't say it's necessarily a flaw, but one of the downsides for me is that it definitely has like 8 plot lines it keeps going back to between them. Like, next week's episode is probably going to have nothing to do with this week's. It's probably going to have something to do with Lion or something, you know, because that seems to be the trend. So
was that the screen cap you sent me, or?
Oh, no, that was from a past episode. Oh. So something that was very interesting was, obviously Pearl is a big driving force. We talked about how they're protecting the Earth, and there's a lot of, like, different gems. In a previous episode, they were in a pyramid-shaped thing that kept, like, intertwining rooms. And, one of the things, they fell through a hole, and, it had, like, some display markings that I don't think you really would pay attention because it kind of pans by really quickly. And you see Rose fighting against an army of, darkened gems, which look very much like the holes that we saw with Amethyst. Mm-hmm. So that's very interesting. So at least that war is a very old one.
Yeah.
If there even is a war. But I'm assuming there is. There's enough evidence behind it that...
If not a war, an uprising.
Yeah. Which is very interesting, because you tend to think of Rose as a very, like, compassionate character and very loving and very protective. But keep in mind that she has a weapon room and a cannon.
Well, don't mess with a mama when her cubs are around.
No, she's not related to any of them.
No, what I mean is you mess with anybody she cares about, she's going to bring the big guns.
You get fucked up.
Yeah. It's like, you don't mess with a mama.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, she was a mama even before Steven, I think.
I can see that. She's very, you know... Well, she also had the plant creature army that we saw from the one before. And overall, like, you know, she's definitely a force to be reckoned with.
Yeah.
And I think that's one of the frustrations for the gems is that, like, to harness Steven's power, or Rose's power, they now have to harness it through Steven. Mm-hmm. So I think that's something that's always constantly on their mind. A fan theory that I read that I thought was really, really interesting was some people think Garnet might actually be two gems fused together. The reason for this fan theory was because she has two gems. She's the only one that the set so far that has them. So, keep in mind that you might be thinking, well, wouldn't she be, like, split up into two eventually? Well, Pearl said in the episode with Sugalite that if a gem stays too long merged together, they start to lose their original personalities and just become one.
Hmm.
So, Pearl might potentially be two separate gems.
Garnet,
yeah. I get their names. Red one. Red one.
Player Red.
Yeah. But that's interesting. I thought that was kind of a cool theory.
I didn't even think about the two gems bit.
Yeah, because I could tell when I mentioned it, you're like, that's stupid, Steven. Well, I could see it on your face.
It was through a message.
It was through your... I saw it through your eyes. You're like, that's stupid. That's dumb.
It didn't dawn on me until you just now mentioned the two gems.
Mm-hmm. But that's basically Steven Universe and all the spoilers we got for it. But really two really good, strong episodes. Next week, I'm really excited because we can actually talk about Gravity Falls as well as new episodes coming out this week for Steven Universe and, I believe, Ninja Turtles. Mm-hmm. And, I guess, Power Rangers. That's going to be the 4 shows we're going to be recapping each week. So be excited. So for the new show, our new medium that we watched together is Nico and the Sword of Light.
Hmm.
If you haven't seen it, it's an Amazon pilot. It's not a full-fledged series yet. It's in the voting process. You can, I guess, like, right now, with Netflix making original series, a lot of other companies, Yahoo Screen, Amazon Prime, they're all kind of like, well, we need to do that, too. And so, Amazon Prime, there's two shows I've seen of it that is Amazon Prime original programming. That is Zombieland, the TV series, which, guess what? Zombieland had a TV series for one episode after the movie. And then you have this thing. Real quick about the Zombieland series, it was okay. I enjoyed it enough. I would continue watching it. I really do like Zombieland. You've seen my giant poster.
Takes up a whole wall.
I have it from the ceiling to the floor. It was for IMAX advertisements, and a friend of mine, I was like, you work at a theater, right? He's like, can you get me a Zombieland poster? And he's like, I'll try. He comes to speak. I was at school at the time, and he's just like, all right, dude, I don't know if you're going to want it. It's the only one they had left, and it's this giant freaking poster. It's taller than me. And so anyways, Zombieland, the series, my biggest beef with it was that they did switch out actors. They couldn't afford the main, you know, TV actors, so they went with the cheaper ones. And the quality didn't necessarily super drop, but definitely without Woody Harrelson, there's just not as much charisma with Tallahassee. And the other cat, and then, you know, without Emma Stone, there's the hotness level of the series dropped a little bit. For the other two, I'm okay with the changes.
I don't know. I feel like you kind of need a movie budget just for, like, what were the special effects like?
It was all right. It was all right. It was decent.
I'm thinking of is Piano on Zombie.
So they introduced a new character that's only heard through voice. She's on a radio, and so she's communicating with other survivors. And so, like, basically what happened was they decided that they want to, like, make a new place for their home. They're tired of traveling. And so they were also looking for new people to be part of their family. And every time they found a survivor, the survivor would accidentally die. It was hilarious. It's a really funny plot. But, like, every time they would meet up with someone, there's, like, one guy that, like, came with the cookies. And then, like, at midway while they're just talking and he's in the background, a zombie just comes and gets him.
Oh, man.
So the story-wise, it was interesting. There's two bits from the story that I didn't like from Zombieland, the series. First off, the opening scene is showing Tallahassee in his original form, like, before the Zombieland apocalypse. And Tallahassee was a character that did not need to be explained any further. I did not need to know what his day job was. And it turns out it was basically a intern.
Office mailman.
Yeah, basically that. He gives people coffee and stuff. And he was just an office bitch.
Yeah.
And so in the thing, there's like this like 10-minute long scene or so. It's really long of the two people, not even Tallahassee talking. He shows up being a wimp, and then like a zombie hits the wall of the glass of the window. And that was a really weird way of saying window. And so basically, then he's like, yeehaw, you know, takes some stuff and is able to just start kicking zombie butt. Like,
they hinted at such a deeper reasoning for his zombie killing badassery in the movie.
Yeah, it just wasn't needed. It was one of those things where the adding new stuff to the character actually weakened it. Like, keep in mind that, like, in horror movies and certain characters, horror movies are scary to you because they don't explain stuff. As soon as they reveal the monster, it's no longer scary.
But it's the same with characters.
Because your imagination sells you more than anything written. Anything that I could come up with will not be nearly as scary as your own mind.
Yeah.
Same thing with characters. Characters that are cool have very little information about them because that mystery makes them cool. You get to fill in your own gaps. As soon as you start building their history with it, there's a pretty good chance it's probably got me as cool as you think it was.
Vegeta.
Exactly.
It's the Vegeta effect. The more common the badass character appears, the more you have to reveal about him.
Mm-hmm. The other thing about Zombieland, the series, I didn't like was Columbus and what was Emma Stone's character's name?
Crap, I can't remember.
I can't remember, but they broke up. So they got together in the Zombieland movie, and then in the TV series, they gave a really stupid reason for them to break up, and so Columbus is trying to catch her, you know, rehook up with her. And they basically reset that one, so there's a would-they-won't-they story. And that just didn't really work out with me. But we're supposed to be talking about Nico and the Sword of Light. It is basically the darkness has taken over the world. Nico is the last human, at least it's implied that much, and he's a big-headed Aang. He's like Oob-Aang merged together.
with the voice of Milo from Korra.
He sounds like Milo. It reminds me a lot of Avatar The Last Airbender. Kind of like, imagine Avatar The Last Airbender and like My Little Pony art styles merged into one. Mm-hmm. That's about what you're going to get. It's animated by Titmouse, which I love Titmouse. It's like, if there was a studio I wanted to work for, it most likely would be Titmouse.
Yeah, that'd be awesome.
I actually thought my friend Colin worked on it. Colin's the guy that does Lloyd the Rocking Unicorn. They use a lot of his post-production techniques as well as like lighting effects. So I swear I thought it was in there, but I did not see him in the credits. But anyways, it's got an all-star cast. Within the first episode alone, I don't know who voices Milo slash Nico, whatever his name was, the guy with the Sword of Light. But a lot of background characters is D. Dudley Baker. Is that how you pronounce it?
D. Bradley Baker.
I don't know why I can never get that one right.
You can't get any names right.
Shut up, you.
I'm fired again.
Tristan is double fired. But basically the voice of all the Ben 10 aliens is in this for like one small role. Jim Cummings is the narrator and a bunch of different little roles. And Tom Kenny is a little annoying rat.
He looks like Splinter's Mini-Me.
He looks like a lemur. He looks like Samubafu and Splinter merged together. But overall, the writing is okay. The story,
some high points.
There is a lot of potential with this cartoon. So much potential, but the problem is, it's just like some of the writing's really bad. Some of the like lines, you didn't get all of them either. It's weird. It's got a backstory that feels like it's more like preteen teenager style story, like you know Avatar. But then it's got the writing dialogue of a younger TV show. Like Bakugan or something. But it does look great for Toon Boom slash Flash animation with a little bit of After Effects attached to it. Though I do think that the main character Nico's head's a little too big. So his body's not really proportionate.
Yeah, like scale up his body just a little bit. I wouldn't shrink the head. I would scale his body up a little bit.
But the concept art at the end during
gorgeous.
They're so good. In the credits, they show concept art of all the characters. And, oh man, he looks so much better in that form. And they obviously had to simplify his character design for the Toon Boom Flash animation. I'm not sure what Titmouse uses. I believe it's Toon Boom. I think most cartoons now have moved from Flash to Titboom. I think Toon Boom. Which is interesting. The other day, apparently, Toon Boom got really cheap on Amazon. I almost bought it. If it wasn't for the fact that I had to spend so much on my computer. I think it was like less than $300, which was really sweet. Yeah. Normally it's super expensive. No, I think it was only $100.
Dang.
Yeah, but if it wasn't for the fact that I just spent like $400 on my computer, yeah. I would have bought it just to experiment with it.
Yeah.
But overall, the plot of the episode is Nico has a Sword of Light, darkness is taken over, and only the sword can cure it. So think a Master Sword, but with more light. And he has to follow a trail to stop the evil.
It feels very much like a video game plot turned into a cartoon.
It reminds me a little bit of Dragon Ball Z as well.
A little bit.
Like in terms of story, it's basically Dragon Ball Z, or Dragon Ball and Avatar merged together. In terms of art style, it's Avatar and My Little Pony. And then you said Waifu?
Wakfu.
Wakfu,
a gorgeously animated French production. It's on Netflix. Do not bother with the English dub.
I'm going to watch the English dub.
Oh, you will tear your ears out.
Guess what we're watching for next week's new episode TV show thing. By the way, if it wasn't for the computer breaking, we were going to do Strange Magic for the last week. I got some free tickets for my birthday. From my school, I might end up doing that. We might watch it still, maybe. If you guys are interested, let me know.
Tell them you'd rather have us review Jupiter Ascending.
So, two viewings of Strange Magic. It is.
Oh.
We will watch it twice, just to be really thorough. But no, so Nico and the Sword of Light. Talk to me, Tristan.
It was, it had a just gorgeously done animation. I mean, it just felt like a piece was missing. Like, I cannot put my finger on it. There's just something production-wise where it felt like they had to cut something or throw out a character. Like, it felt a little lonely. like, even with that little lemur dude popping in and all the animals talking. And
there's kind of a running gag of, like, Nico is trying to find a sidekick within the episode.
Yeah.
And that might be it. But it definitely feels like 90% there. There is a lot of potential for it, but
it's something real magic for that 10%.
It feels really off. I agree with you. I can't pinpoint what the appeal is missing, but like there's just something that makes it seem like a cheaper version of a different show.
Now, I will say this. Even with that 10% missing, if there was another episode next week, I would watch it.
I'd probably watch it, yeah.
But, like, I feel like this show has nowhere to go but up.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
And maybe that's what will hook people.
Maybe. Well, we don't even know if it's going to get a series. I know it's got, like, either a graphic novel or a iPhone game. I haven't really downloaded it. I think it's free anyways. But cool. I know that Amazon pops up with it, so I don't know if it's a Kindle thing or what.
I didn't even know you could play games on the Kindle.
Yeah, they've been making the Kindles more and more like tablets. Alright, so what I want to do now is, I don't know how long the particular podcast is going to go today, because it is getting kind of late. I got to wake up early. But I do have a list of topics I want to talk about, news-related stuff. So first thing I want to talk about, because I know you're excited about it, is Ghostbusters is getting a Kickstarter that is a tabletop game.
With illustrations and sculpts by Dan Schoenig, who does the IDW Ghostbusters comics.
It is great. That sold me alone. Like, I didn't even actually look to see how the game played. I was like, oh my god, I can get little statues of that style? Yes.
Now, if they were just painted. But they're for a board game, so they can't be too detailed.
Well, they look great. The board game looks pretty good. Apparently, the Kickstarter disagrees, because it showed none of the board game in the video. We wound up watching it with my roommate, and, like, the entire time, it's like, we can't wait. Like, someone says in the video, I can't wait to see it. And I'm just like, me either.
Well, it shows people playing it, but it doesn't show it actually being played. Like, it shows the people's reactions.
Right. It never once goes down and looks at the thing.
Probably because they were having, like, a crappy beta copy there.
Most likely. But there's a really cute girl in that video. the female Ghostbuster.
Was eyes, like, in your head, man.
I was just saying. Steven's just lonely right now.
Send him hugs, people.
I found out what a Swedish hug looks like. So I got an email from a lovely girl from Sweden. Her name is Erica. And she sent me a little fan art of a Swedish hug. For those who are not familiar, which apparently is everyone I've told this story to, it's my face and her boobs. It's basically a boat hug. And it made me smile. It made me grin. But yeah, so, like, so Ghost, that girl was just really cute in that video. I don't know, something about it was like, oh man, and she's dressed like a Ghostbuster. Yes!
See, that's what you gotta look forward to for the new movie.
Oh,
nice. Lots of lady Ghostbusters cosplaying.
Mm-hmm. So it's a board game. It reminded me a lot of Zombicide, if you ever played that, which is a zombie game, but with Ghost. I'm excited about that, and, I don't know, I wound up spending a little too much money on the backing, because I wanted some of the Kickstarter exclusive stuff.
Yeah.
And it's got like 30 days. I'll worry about that in 30 days. I should have money then.
Yeah. And, I mean, since it's a board game with it's got a modular setup, they can make expansions for it. Fans can make homebrew expansions.
Oh no, it definitely looks like it has all the potential of Zombicide, which I don't know if you guys ever played Zombicide. It's a rather expensive game because it has a lot of metal, a lot of plastic pieces. Like card games are really cheap because it's just cards. It's just printing off.
Mm-hmm.
With board games, they actually have pieces, plastic. They get more expensive, but they tend to be a lot more higher quality and a lot more fun.
Yeah.
And if you guys are into it, or if you have like a GameStop that like not GameStop but like a game place you can go to, a game palace if you will, we have game palaces here, and that they have like open copy of the games. Game Preserve. What's Game Palace?
I don't know. I remember there being a Toys R Us competitor called Toy Castle. That's about as close as I can get in my mind.
Well, we have a Game Preserve, I'm friends with one of the owners, and that's just embarrassing. I tried to give him free advertisement, and I fuck it up. Go, Steven.
Woo!
I high-fived myself.
That was him smacking his forehead.
No, I high-fived myself, damn it. Tristan, I'll kill you!
So, not only am I fired, I'm murdered!
If You should have said, if you find me dead, don't believe the suicide note.
He's holding that stylus very threateningly. I'm going to end up with it in my jugular.
Anyways, Ghostbuster Tabletop, I'm excited. It's going to be good. Play Zombicide if you haven't. Check it out. Google it or whatever. It's rather expensive, being like $80, but it's definitely worth it. I have a lot of fun, especially with you tend to lose the first time you play. And you get to play again and win because you know what not to do.
Yeah.
For example, for me, separating from the group and busting down a door that had a room full of zombies. Let's see here. The other thing I want to... So we have a long list of things. WizardCon. I know you're going to that. I'm not.
I'm going to WizardCon Indy, the first WizardCon to ever come to Indianapolis.
Is it Wizard World?
Wizard World comic conventions. I'm not sure what the whole title of it is, but it's the ones that you usually hear about in like New York or San Diego or Chicago, the biggest of the big. They're a bit predatory in where they place their conventions because they want to be the only convention that month. But they didn't place it near PopCon, so I'm like, I'm not worried.
For you guys are familiar with it, I'm actually helping out a convention that's local here called Indie PopCon. I'm the YouTube track coordinator. Basically, my job is to contact YouTubers that people might potentially want to see. We did snag some people, and I can tell you, between three people, we have all the YouTubers that are together, we have about 6 to 7 million subscribers to total. Wow. And that's just with like two or three YouTubers. So that's pretty exciting. Granted, one of them has 5.8 million. I'm not going to specify who, because I'm not allowed to yet. But he's rather big, and I think people are going to be really excited to see him. But and then I had like a meeting with Frederator, hopefully trying to get them to help sponsor or bring in Frederator animators that are local.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
That'd be really neat. But I'm working with Indie PopCon. It was something that like most of you guys probably found me through. Well, if you long time, you know, followers, which awesome you, because I can't imagine anyone sticking around for 2 years, let alone listening to a 2 hour. You can't be a follower. You're my friend. I know you were. He rose his hand. But anyways, thanks to Indie PopCon, I met a lot of really great connections. Wade from Lord Minion 77. He's the reason why I did all the Five Nights at Freddy cartoons, and that's how I made a lot of following. You know, a lot of my people. I jumped like 3/4 of my audience is from just December. You know,
wow,
which is insane. But thanks to them, I was able to make really good connections, and it's been helping me grow on YouTube.
Do you know if any big YouTubers have been, are any YouTubers, animators, artists that are going to be at Wizard Indie? Or?
I don't know about Wizard. I can tell you more about Indie PopCon.
I was just curious.
Well, with Wizard World, I'm not really interested in it whatsoever.
Oh, yeah, no, it's a big corporate to-do.
I know, but it's like, I looked at the cast list, and I'm like, none of these people are that exciting to me. Like, oh, cool, the Green Ranger's there. Oh, wait, Green Ranger's at every convention in Indiana.
He's cloned himself.
I know, but like, I've seen him around so often that it's no longer special to see the Green Ranger.
See, I've met Rocky, Adam, Aisha, Billy, Alpha 5. You were there. But it's like, I've just got to get Tommy and Kimberly, and then I'll have that team.
I can't believe you haven't seen the Green Ranger yet. Like, he appears so frequently that, like...
He's never... This is, like, his first con in Indy.
Really?
Yeah.
I know that, like... Well, I guess he goes to a lot of... Like, he went to Lexington Comic Con and stuff like that. So I know he's around. I don't know. I've just seen him a lot on cast.
Oh, yeah.
But, like, the Wizard World one, I can't remember who's all there. I think the most exciting thing to me was the voice of Big Bird and Oscar the Grouch is on the cast list.
Yeah.
But, like, aside from that, it's all, like,
Neil Adams, he was kind of the guy who brought Batman into the modern age.
Okay.
In the 70s and 80s, like, he got him away from the Adam West camp.
Oh, but that was the best camp.
Well, he kept a little, like, it was before Batman got, like, super grungy dark, like, before Dark Knight Returns, but after the Adam West era. Mm-hmm. So it was, like, kind of... I want to say a lot of that Batman went into, like, the animated series Batman.
Okay. But yeah, so Wizard World, I know you're excited about it. Yeah. I probably won't go unless, like, because I think it's this weekend, right? So even if I get the podcast up tomorrow, none of the people here would be like, I'm going, I want to see you, you know? Yeah. But my con list right now is VidCon, Gen Con, both as attendees and then Indie PopCon as a guest. So I'll have a booth at Indie PopCon and the other two I'll just be walking around. So if any of you guys are at those, VidCon is in California and then Gen Con and Indie PopCon are in Indianapolis. And if any of you guys want to see me or Tristan, Tristan, you probably wouldn't be able to get like the like a guest appearance type thing, but you could be my plus support. One, you know. But if any of you guys really want to see me at a convention, basically request me. Get your friends to request me. That could help me get some funding to go to those conventions. Because the hardest part about conventions for me, even with me being a slightly bigger YouTuber, like I got a modest 100,000. That's not a lot, not by a long shot. Not when you have these people with millions, you know. I don't make that much off YouTube. I make enough off YouTube right now from the last few months that I could potentially quit my teaching job and focus more on YouTube, which, by the way, might be happening.
Yeah.
I've been talking with them. I was really worried about talking to my boss about it because I know we've lost a couple of instructors. But next quarter, I only have one class compared to this quarter, I have three. And it seems like my focus is shifting anyway. Yeah. So
you're shifting from what was once your day job is now your side job, and what's your day job is your dream job.
Right. So that's really cool, but it really does not make enough for me to, like, travel places. But if a convention thinks, you know, oh, man, he's got, you know, nice enough following, we would like him, you guys invite, you know, telling the convention that you want me will help me get that. And, there's a place, I forgot where, I think it was Kineticon, I almost went to, because they would actually pay for traveling.
Oh, nice.
I wound up not doing it because I was going through a breakup at the time.
Yeah.
So it was one of those things where it's like, I wasn't ready for that.
Yeah. Also, con-wise, I'm going to be at all 3 days of Anime Crossroads. The mm-hmm. 20... I want to say it's the 20... I got to bring up my calendar.
Anime Crossroads here in Indiana.
It's like our first big anime convention here.
It's our only anime convention here.
We're small.
Yeah.
But it's the 20th, 21st, and the 22nd.
Of this month?
Yeah.
Okay. And so the following week?
Yeah, I'm going to be volunteering at that, so I'll be hanging around. Hopefully, you know, we don't have a lot of big guests. We've got, Lisa Ortiz, who was the, voice of,
That sounds so familiar. Why do I know that?
She was the voice of the main character in Slayers. Lena Inverse.
I know her for something else.
She's done a lot of stuff, but like...
Was she the voice of Amy Rose and, Chopper from One Piece from the Four Kids era?
I'm gonna laugh if that was true.
I think that might be it. But while he's looking that up, speaking of conventions, I do want to talk about... I was watching the MAGFest panels, right?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, like, somewhat... Like, someday, I kind of hope that, you know, I get invited to be a panel and I actually have people. Like, I'm going to be doing a panel at Indie PopCon. Is it that?
I have no signal.
Okay. But, like, I'm going to be doing a panel at Indie PopCon. And it's probably going to be with other YouTubers, like Lore Minion again.
Cool.
And, like, because last time, I know a lot of people showed up for Lore Minion. It wasn't me, you know, like... No one even knew who I was, because I only had like 45,000 subscribers at the time. So, you know, I'm nothing. So, I have about the same amount of subscribers as Lore Minion did last year. So, I'm kind of hoping there will be a couple people there wanting to ask questions and stuff. And, like, I've questioned about whether or not, like, doing, like, an artist panel or something. And I'm just really scared that no one's going to show up. Like, that's terrifying, and it's going to be an empty room.
You did that. I know the Five Nights at Freddy's is not your most proud moment.
Yeah.
But... That will get people in there.
Well, I mean, I don't think the panel... come to the panel with the guy that did an animation on the internet about Five Nights at Freddy's. Okay.
What I mean is like, just, you know...
Best subtitle ever, by the way.
Just get it out there that, you know, you're getting artists together and you're getting yourself out there. And, you know, don't be afraid to whore yourself out.
Well, I'm not afraid, but, like, it's one of those things. I'm just terrified. Anyway, so I'm watching MAGFest, and I watched, you know, the Ninja Sex Party. I wound up, well, with YouTube having this autoplay thing going on. I don't know if you witnessed that, where it's like you play something, and it just automatically skips to something else. And it's like, it's weird. But I watched the Ninja Sex Party, and I watched the Normal Boots one. And then I noticed, I also wound up watching the Game Grumps one, because it kind of automatically connected to it. I'm like, okay, cool. And what was interesting, I was watching the Normal Boots one, and apparently everyone wanted a hug. And with conventions, especially big ones like that, they're just really notorious for, like, you know, getting people sick.
Yeah. Con crud.
Right. And so, like, It was just really interesting because, like, Jonchon's clearly not one to hug people, you know? But, like, everyone's going out of their way to try to make some kind of excuse to hug, you know? And I just remember in the comments people were just, like, talking about, like, oh, these people trying to get excuses for hugs. And I'm just like, I want hugs. Hugs would be nice.
And then after the con, you're laid up with the flu for 3 weeks.
I think if I had that many people showing up that wanted hugs, I would probably most likely be like, all right, guys, can't do it during the panel because if I have to hug everyone, it would, like, kill the time. So after the convention, we'll do hugs. Just all the hugs, you know. But it was just really interesting to see, you know, like, him just be like, all right, let's hug, no more hugs, you know, because everyone wanted one, you know. And it was just insane to see, like, the amount of dedication to their following. It's insane.
Wow.
Like, with the Game Grumps and stuff, there's people, like, making things for them. Like, there's one person that was, like, looking for a candle that, like, Danny Sexbang mentioned in one of the videos. And, like, was searched for a whole year trying to find this candle and still couldn't find one. You know, and, like...
What kind of candle was it?
I don't remember, but it was a certain scent. And, you know, she wanted to get Danny Sexbang that. There was people traveling from out of country to see them. It's just like, I couldn't imagine that, you know?
Mm-hmm.
It's just insane. So
you were one... It finally loaded.
Yeah, was it right?
She was Brain Boost Chopper and Speed Boost Chopper.
She was Chopper.
She was Sabrina, Oshawa, Flannery, Karina. She's done a lot of Pokemon voices.
Okay, but that's all I need to know. She's the four kids voice actor.
And
she's,
Amy Rose.
She's going to be there? That's interesting. Do I have anything Chopper or no? Well, she was kind of terrible as Chopper. Four Kids, One Piece was terrible. But anyway, so MAGFest, watching the things. It was really cool to see those guys do it. What was interesting was the Normal Boots convention, or the Normal Boots thing, had Fario, Micah something. I can't remember his last name. But I remember him on Pixeltendo. I don't know if you're familiar with that site at all.
No clue.
The Spritest Resource, TSR.
Oh, okay.
I was a really big fan on there. I was Silver Dabolt or Silver Bolt on there. Apparently, I was a furry back in high school. Because, like, my character was a vegetarian wolf that wore Hawaiian shirts. And, like, that was just my avatar character, because at the time I was vegetarian. At the time I wore Hawaiian shirts, and, you know.
Never knew you went vegetarian in
any time. 2 years. 2 years vegetarian. Yeah.
Worst time of your life, I bet.
And, it was alright. It wasn't that bad. It wasn't until I moved into college where I couldn't afford vegetarianism.
Yeah.
But, yeah, so, Fario's there, and... When I remember Fario, I never actually seen him physically, but, like, I follow him on Twitter. He refuses to follow me for whatever reason. Not upset about that at all. it was one of those things where, like, he's responded to me a couple times on Twitter, but he clearly does not want to follow me. And it was, like, one of those things where it's, like, I can't help but feel snubbed by it. But I'm not, like, mad or anything. It's fine. I make annoying posts. I mean, I just posted for 4 days straight about how I'm going crazy because I don't have a computer.
Send help.
Ain't nobody have time for that. So, yeah. But anyways, it's interesting to see him on there. And keep in mind that the physical form of him, my vision of him, like his inner self, was also a furry. It was basically purple tails with pants. That was his character for a while. Ferrario.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And it was just really interesting to see people that you know, appear there, you know, like, on a panel. Like, it's just really cool to see a friend work with Jontron, which I'm a big fan of Jontron. Yeah, he might be, the least politically correct person on Twitter, and he might piss off a lot of people, but he still entertains me. I enjoy him, you know? But I thought it was very interesting, and I don't know. I didn't want to complain about, like, I got snubbed, but,
nah.
Was that gangster?
I don't know, man.
But yeah, I mean, I just thought it was interesting. The other set of news, speaking of Jontron, is the Banjo-Kazooie spiritual sequel. So back in 2012, this Twitter account called Mingo Jingo, which is a enemy in Banjo-Tooie, a robotic mumbo-jumbo, right? That account started talking about potentials of a spiritual sequel to Banjo-Kazooie, doing little things like, oh, this is a fan game of Banjo-Kazooie with Unity. I think Unity would be the program we use. And that's a little of a bit of a red flag where it's like, you don't know Unity? Like, that's a very common engine used to make games, you know?
Mm-hmm.
A little weird. But, so anyways, they're just posting about it. And it was kind of like them getting hits. Seeing where the interest of a new Banjo-Kazooie-styled game would be.
Okay.
And so I am going to pull it up for you, Tristan, so you can see it, but they released an image of the Banjo-Kazooie Spirits sequel. four or three years later, we finally got some information about it. What was interesting was doing some research on it. We found out that the project got canceled at one point because they didn't want to half-ass it.
Good for them.
Yeah. The guy who did the music, Grant Kurskall? Kurskall? I can't remember his last name. But Grant talked about how the project got canceled due to everyone having personal stuff in their lives. And so this is the image, by the way. So, yeah, that's the thing. So he mentioned that the project got canceled for a bit, and then the Mingo Jingo account just kind of disappeared. Well, a little bit later this month, Mingo Jingo posted again and changed its name. It had, like, rendering, update, do-do-do-do-do. And then what was interesting, if you go back to Mingo Jingo on Twitter, that account is now some little kid that apparently likes to play video games. The original account is now Platonic Games. A new studio founded by a bunch of Axe Cop. It was founded by Axe Cop and a bunch of older. Man, what am I trying to say here? Sorry, I'm trying to like.
We are tired.
We are tired. It is almost midnight here, which isn't really late for a lot of people, but when you get up at 6 o'clock in the morning for your job, it is pretty late. What was I talking about?
Banjo.
Oh, no, I got the banjo, but what was. Platonic Games. Is founded by a bunch of people that used to work at Rare. Hopefully it's the good people. And we keep in mind that like we've had some really terrible games. Like look at Red Button, which was founded by a bunch of ex people from Asylum and Naughty Dog, and then they made Sonic Boom. Yeah. But anyway, so Project Ukulele, we don't know the real name of it yet, but we got an image of two characters hidden behind a Donkey Kong Country styled leaf, like, you know, greenery. And it kind of, I've looked at the image a lot. I've lightened it up just to see what it is. It's really hard to tell. It kind of looks like either a reptile and a bird or a cat creature, a tiger and a bird. It's really hard to tell what's going on there. And it's got me really, really excited. You can see there where it's...
Oh, that's totally a cat.
Yeah. I can't tell if it's like a T-Rex thing. I don't know. But we do know... I guess it makes sense that they're doing a bird. I feel like that's a little too close to Banjo-Kazooie, but I'm excited. If there's one thing to know about me, is I love Banjo-Kazooie.
Don't blame you.
Talk about it.
I played it twice in high school. It was right around the time my N64 was crapping out on me.
I love the Xbox version. The Xbox Live version is probably the best version of it. But Banjo-Kazooie is just a game I really, really love. And it sucks that, like, you know, it doesn't have the best reputation anymore. The first two games are pretty good. The second one was, like, did what you needed to do for a sequel, keeping all the same stuff and just adding on to it. Some of the stuff they added to it wasn't the greatest, like the first-person shooter segments, which is all the rage with GoldenEye. I don't know, it felt weird and really weird. That's a weird sentence to say.
Go home, Steven, you're drunk.
Yeah, but I don't know. I love Banjo-Kazooie. And one thing I really want, and by the way, I keep hinting at it, and I have yet to get it. Send it to my P.O. Box, guys. But I really want a Banjo-Kazooie Papercraft. Someone was actually going to make me a Metalcraft version of it. Of the Banjo-Kazooie model. The person no longer, like, follows me or whatever. I guess he gave up on it, but, like, I haven't heard from him in years. It was when I first started. He was going to make me one. I got really excited about it because I really want a 64 model version of Banjo to put on my shelf. And I don't really understand, Papercraft.
Oh, yeah. It'd be easier just to download a model and send it to Shapeways.
Yeah. So I'm just kind of like, if anyone that is listening truly loves me, make me a Banjo-Kazooie thing.
Okay, Batman.
But yeah, so, by the way, P.O. Box, I don't know if I'm going to continue it. I got like 4 more months left or 3 or more months. Like, I know I went through half of it. I've only got one thing through the mail so far, and the P.O. Box is rather expensive.
Yeah.
And, like, not that I'm, like, trying to get people to send me stuff except for the Banjo-Kazooie thing. Send that. Send all the Banjo-Kazooie things. It's one of those things where I just, if no one's going to use it, I'm not going to spend a couple of hundred to open it up each month. Or, for the year. If I was getting something once a month, that would be okay. I don't necessarily want, like, drawings. I don't want people, like, you know, some people, like, really, really like getting free games and things like that. I'm not even for that. I really love the one thing I did get, the Gimpy over there. It's sitting up on my wall. You can see right now, Tristan.
Yeah.
I love that. Thank you, Mr. Optimism. But, like, it's, you know, besides that, it...
You want people to be creative.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I love, like, you know, if you want to draw, like, physical fan art instead of scanning it in, you want to do that, that'd be awesome. If you want to write hand letters like Mr. Optimism did, that'd be awesome. But, like, right now, it's like I keep checking it, and it's just like there's nothing there. So, I don't know. Like, that sounds really, really, like, dumb where it's just like, oh, man, no one's sending my stuff. Send me stuff. But it's one of those things where I'm just giving a fair warning because I know I haven't really, like, made a video about the P.O. Box. I've just kind of, like, the P.O. Box is for the people that, you know, care enough to watch every video. You know, that's supposed to be for hardcore fans. And... right now, if it's being underutilized, there's no reason to, you know, actually, you know, keep it.
Yeah.
If I was making more money, I wouldn't mind, you know, but...
It's what it is.
Yeah. There's one more topic on the list of things.
Two more. Yeah. But I'll be short about...
Oh, did you add something? Did you?
No, the Netflix thing.
Oh, yeah. I don't know why I forgot to add that. Well, first off, real quick, Spider-Man. It's now part of the Marvel Cinematic Universe.
Still partially owned by Sony.
Still partially owned by Sony, who gets final say on anything they do with Spider-Man, which is both scary because that means, like, you know, if Marvel's like, well, that doesn't go with our Cinematic Universe, fuck it, we want it, you know? Mm-hmm. That's really, really terrifying. But for the most part, I welcome this change. I think we all want Spider-Man in the Marvel Universe.
Yeah, I love that picture of Iron Man saying, we have money, and Spidey's just like, oh, thank God. I mean, it's been needed. Like, I loved the Amazing Spider-Man movies, but they were, like, other than Andrew Garfield and his spectacular performance.
Oh, and Emma Stone. Emma Stone was pretty good.
Emma Stone was good. It just felt like they were pushing too hard too fast. It's like, we don't need another origin story.
Oh, definitely not.
It's like, just do like the cartoon did and just show a quick flashback of him getting bit by some altered spider.
I mean, they could still spend 2 minutes on it, like, open narration. So, you know, I was just a normal high schooler. And then, which I hope they age him up a little bit and just go straight to college.
No, they're actually trying to find somebody who looks a lot younger than Andrew Garfield.
Really?
So they might be going for, this is a kid playing with the big boys. Like, okay. Which would be a good dynamic.
Okay.
And
I'm still hoping for... I will always jump on Donald Glover for Spider-Man.
Miles Morales would be a great Spider-Man for the MCU.
I wouldn't even mind being Peter Parker, to be honest. Yeah. But it's one of those things where my roommate has a friend, Nathan, and... It's one of those things where, like, you mentioned Black Spider-Man, he goes on rants, he's
the I'm not racist type.
He's fully admitted it. he's okay with racism, but he's just like, you know, like, there's 50 years of comics that say otherwise. He is a white character. I'm just like, there's nothing in Spider-Man's description that dictates what his race is. You could have it anything. In fact, there was an Indian Spider-Man.
Yeah, that was a good comic.
Was it?
Yeah, it was actually really cool.
I couldn't get past the Aladdin pants.
Sorry.
That was a legit laugh. Did you hear that, guys?
Those do make me giggle. But it worked with the setting. But what I'm looking forward to is, one thing I've always wanted in the comics with Spider-Man is kind of like Norman Osborn as the head of Oscorp should be like this big competitor with Tony Stark.
Oh, that'd be pretty cool.
Because, like,
wasn't the patron, the Iron Patriot supposed to be the Green Goblin?
Yeah. Yeah, it was Norman Osborn as, you know, taking over Iron Man's spot on the Avengers.
Hmm.
But one thing I loved about the Tobey Maguire Spider-Man movies was Green Goblin's design. It looked like an actual tactical tech type suit.
Yeah, but I think most people didn't like that.
I'm just saying, make it look like Norman Osborn's number one development strategy is corporate espionage. So just have him, like, steal an Iron Man suit. Steal a super soldier serum, combine the two, and that's how he becomes Green Goblin.
That's one way to go about it. But, yeah, so Spider-Man's joining the Marvel Universe. That's cool. That's exciting. Nothing really to talk about, just Black Spider-Man. I mean,
On the Universe. Netflix front, they had a trailer for the Daredevil Netflix series.
Oh, yeah?
They're keeping it really gritty and reality-based, even though it's about a guy who runs around in black spandex with no eyes. But
Oh, nice.
They say he will have a legit superhero suit about midway through.
Oh, okay, so they're holding out on it?
That's yeah, they're cool. doing, like, he just dresses up in all black for the start of it and puts a thing okay. over his face. And, like, I'm like, with Spider-Man in there now, you could actually have, like, just have, like, a throwaway scene where Marvel Cinematic Universe Spidey's sitting on a corner of a building and Daredevil swings by. It's like, hey, Spidey, hey, Devil.
You know, it made me realize that every single superhero is in New York.
Yeah.
That really hurts the universe a little bit. Like, insurance
rates are through the roof.
It's already, well, I mean, like, it's already really difficult to believe that, like, oh man, you know, during a Thor movie, you can't just call up Tony Stark and get help, or, you know, Captain America, like, why can't the Hulk come help out, you know?
Hulk have yoga.
Sorry, I'm a little busy. I can see where Tony's, like, you know, kind of... they just need to, like, every movie has, like, a throw in way. It's like, sorry, I'm getting laid, peace. You know.
That's one thing I liked in the comics is they did actually start, like, expanding where heroes lived. Like, Scarlet Spider moved to the total opposite coast just so he could escape the fact that he was a bad clone of Peter Parker.
So, speaking of Netflix, there's a certain series we need to talk about.
All rumor, but I'm excited.
Apparently, there may or may not be a Netflix original series, Legend of Zelda series, live action. And that's really all we know about it, but it's really weird knowing that Nintendo hates anything to do with not video game versions of their video games. Maybe with the whole Pac-Man having its own animated series, granted produced by Nintendo, this might be open a way for them to kind of, like, jump into new territory.
Yeah, I mean, they've had a bad run. You know, they did the Mario Brothers movie.
Which was awesome. Best movie ever.
That movie almost gave the guy who played Luigi alcoholism.
Really?
Yeah, he and the guy who played Mario, between takes.
Bob Haskins.
Yeah.
No, don't be like...
I'm sorry. My roommates never know who actors are. Okay. So I have to say the role they played. In
no,
movie. I
mean, that's a okay. big role.
Bob Hoskins and John Leguizamo.
That is the guy from Who Framed Roger Rabbit. He's been in stuff.
Yeah. But they would go back to Bob's trailer and see who could do the most shots between takes.
Really?
Because the movie was that bad. Is it Anthony Hopkins who played Koopa?
I think so, yeah.
Or was it Dennis Hopper? I forget who it was.
I think it's Dennis Hopper.
Dennis Hopper. He will never work with anybody affiliated with Nintendo ever again because the studio got him to sign on one script and then put a different script in his hands when he got on set.
Really?
Yeah. Like, there was nothing good about that production.
I'd like to hope and assume that everyone thought it was going to be great, like, while they were working on it. Like, no one, like, questioned it. Like, I want to assume that none of them are actually, like, Nintendo fans or, like, Mario fans. It's like, hey, yeah.
It's just a sci-fi movie.
Yeah.
With dinosaur people.
I don't know. I think I told the story before, but my friend Tristan, or not Tristan, that's you.
No.
My other friend Jake. You met Jake.
Yeah.
For people that need to imagine Jake, imagine a guy with, like, goat-like facial hair, a ginger skinny guy, and a skullet. A skullet is when you're going bald and have a mullet. Jake does not sound like the most awesome person in the world. But Jake is the most awesome person in the world. I love Jake. Jake is my favorite person. Like, if I could get someone to do Let's Plays with me, Jake would be that every time. If he didn't live 2 hours away, he's just really funny. He's, like, really good with his, like making jokes on his feet and stuff like that. And, obviously, I'm over here, like, crushing on my friend, as you can tell.
Bromance!
Jake is just a beautiful, beautiful specimen of the human race. But... Jake likes to get shit gifts for Christmases and birthdays. Like, he goes out of his way to find the worst gift possible.
Price is no
excuse. So I feel like I talked about this before, but he got me the Ninja Turtles Next Mutation on DVD, both volume 1 and 2. And for a friend, she really loves Mario. Freaking loves Mario. And he's like, well, have you seen the Super Mario movie? And she's like, no, that sounds terrible. And he's like, no, you need to see it. So... he wound up going out of his way of buying it on VHS and DVD, and on top of that got some of the Super Mario movie toys. So he got, like, the Luigi and he got Bowser with a super scope. Couldn't find Mario. he also got her for Christmas one time, unrelated to Mario, but she hates Duke Nukem, and so he got her both two PS4 or PS3 and 360 versions of it, one of which was a special edition that came with the bust. He got her both versions so she can't say she doesn't have the console for the game.
She should have just said, well, it's not on the Wii. Yeah,
but anyway, so Jake, beautiful man.
All right, awesome. But back to Netflix, back Legend to of Zelda. Hopefully they're gonna take a chance on this. The internet has just been abuzz with it.
Well, okay, so this isn't the first time that someone attempted to do a Zelda series. The people that did the Ninja Turtles movie, the TMNT, the CG one.
Imagine
Studios, which doesn't no longer exist anymore. Turns out it went bankrupt.
Rest in peace.
Which is really shocking, because I feel like Ninja Turtles, that movie did well, but I guess not. Yeah,
box office was weak.
Oh, but it's gone. That sucks. Rest in peace and everything. But they did do a pitch to Nintendo with that style, that TMNT, you know, their own homebrew style. They did, like, a 3-minute, like, animatic animation thing. I think only in animatics on screen or, like, on YouTube that you find. But they did attempt to do it. They did try to make, you know, make a movie out of it or a TV series.
As a pitch.
And Nintendo was like, no. Did you see the Super Mario show? Like, yeah. Never again.
But I mean, if they do this, I mean, the rumor is that they want it to be kind of like that low fantasy Game of Thrones style, but for the whole family. Mm-hmm. And I think that would really work for it. You just need some decent creature effects, some people who don't mind wearing pointy ears for long periods of time, and you need to get Ron Perlman to play Ganon, in my opinion.
And then right now, Zelda Williams, the daughter of the late, great Robin Williams, is kind of on Twitter talking about how she'd be interested in playing a character in The Legend of Zelda.
Everybody wants her to play.
Everyone wants her to be Zelda. She would make a great Zelda, though. I know what Tristan wants her to play as. Tristan?
I want her to be Impa. Like, she's got this really strong facial structure that I think would suit Impa better than Zelda, almost.
So, I think it'd be great for Zelda Williams to play a character. She was in a show. She was in Legend of Korra. She was the season 4 baddie and did a phenomenal job.
Scary in that.
So we know she knows how to act, at least as a bad guy. But I think with the fact that Robin Williams did name her after the game, she almost has a namesake, and I feel like she's a calling for it.
Oh, definitely. I mean, there are people who want the next Zelda game to have a tribute to Robin Williams, even if it's just an NPC.
Mm-hmm. I really, really want the next Zelda game to actually have voice acting, though. It won't happen.
It won't happen.
I want it, but it won't happen.
If they do the Netflix series, I do want, like, the first 5 minutes of whatever they do in the first episode to be totally without voices.
No.
Tension and action.
That will not work at all.
I'm just saying five minutes.
No.
But we were talking about, like, how this could actually...
Wait. So are you saying, like, 5 minutes where, like, it's, like, not silence with text popping up?
No. Like, a tense scene where, like, there's a lot of action or backstory, but there's nobody talking. Like, there's sound effects, there's, you know, like, where in Ocarina of Time they talk about how Link's mother was riding on a horse with him, gravely wounded through the forest and whatnot.
So you think it's going to be Ocarina of Time that they're going to base off of?
Well, one of the things I want is an original. I want them to do something original. Mm-hmm. With, you know, since the Zelda universe always self-references every other game, they can reference whatever they want and still build a very original story. But the best part is they could actually cast different actors every season. Because they could just have each season be a different part of a reincarnation cycle.
Maybe. I don't think they're going to do that. I think it's going to be one continuous story. I want it to be one continuous story.
I mean, look at American Horror Story, where each season's...
getting worse?
I was going with the... It's actors filling similar archetypes, but not always being the same person.
That doesn't work with Zelda, though. Like, it does with that, but I don't think each season is going to be a new story. That works with American Horror Story because it's completely different stories, unrelated to each other. Mm. I believe they are kind of going back and saying they are related. But I mean, like, with the Zelda, if they make a Zelda series, And then, like, season two has nothing to do with season one. That's going to lose a lot of people.
But, I mean, none of the games have, like, other than, like, Majora's Mask.
Majora's Mask, Wind Waker, and Link Between Worlds.
Like, they're part of the same timeline, but it's different steps
in. And then all the Wind Waker, Phantom Hourglass, and
Spirit Tracks. Spirit Tracks is, like, 100 years in the future of Wind Waker.
Are you sure?
Yeah. Oh. It's, like, far in the future. It's past another cycle of heroes.
Okay. But, again, I don't know. That sounds like a bad idea to me.
Well, I mean, I'm just saying, like, build on the whole idea that these are characters who are going to be reincarnated at some point. Like, you could basically reset and do a different story each season. And it wouldn't have to affect the season before it or the season after it.
I know, but, like...
I mean, you could do one season where it's Link versus Link and Zelda versus Ganon, and then the next season is, like, one of the side games where it's, like, Ganon's not always the bad guy.
I mean, I definitely think they could do things like that, but I don't think it needs to be reincarnated where they have new actors and such.
Well, maybe not new actors, but I don't know. I've just always really loved that idea of the spirit of the hero lives on even after. Kind of like the Avatar cycle.
You're trying to turn Zelda into Doctor Who.
More like Avatar, is what I was thinking.
Well, Avatar doesn't change characters each season.
But you get what I mean. The story completes, and there's very little for that hero to do once Ganon's sealed away. Like, he just spends the rest of his life, training?
I would see that being more of a spinoff, not a new season. Mm. But, anyways, so that's cool. That's exciting. Mm-hmm. I was someone's gonna say, but we got onto the whole thing.
Sorry.
But yeah, so, I mean, so a new Zelda series, just a lot of really cool things going on, and, I think for the most part, I think we're going to end the podcast here. I'm losing my mind trying to remember things, and it's clearly not going. I got work in 6 hours.
Yeah, so I'm getting slap happy. So.
You peaked. You peaked it. See that? I'm leaving that in there. Everyone's going to hate you now.
Because
that little bump right there, that really loud noise that you made on my mic, that,
there have been a lot of peaks on this.
Not like that. Not like that. But anyways, guys, I hope you guys enjoyed the new format. I hope you guys are glad that I'm back. It seems like a few of you guys were really worried about me, and I appreciate it, all of you. Keep telling people that you want to see me at conventions, and remember the P.O. Box might be dead.
Yeah.
But we're going to be talking about cool things between Steven Universe, Ninja Turtles, Power Rangers, and Gravity Falls. Keep in mind giving us suggestions for shows or movies you want us to watch and then talk about on the podcast. We'll try to do a new one each week.
Yeah.
And, so hopefully we have a good hopefully we have a good Banjo-Kazooie spiritual sequel. And a cool new Spider-Man, and a Ghostbusters tabletop game.
Isn't that going to be awesome?
It's going to be awesome. So I hope to see you guys soon, and join us on another Raid Quest.
Catch you guys later.